for all of you, as well, as our guests down in front. I'd like to take this opportunity to welcome you to Savannah Arts Academy for the first passage. Let me get it right, Mr. Hattiger. Passport to Excellence lecture series. And we know that Stratton Leopold is a good friend of Savannah Arts, so we are excited that they chose to have this here. And we're also very excited that Dr. Lockme, superintendent of schools, is here. And he's going to get up a little bit. Lockamy is not here to take any questions about the uniform policy. Let's give him a round of applause. Dr. Lockamy, I'd like to see how big our kids look in their uniforms. We're really excited about that. We're going to go ahead and get started. We are fortunate enough today to have Mr. Dave Cartoonin from WSAB. That is exactly what I expect today. Guys, got it? Thank you. Welcome Mr. Dave Cartoonin, who's leaving.
Walking out. Hey, give your principal a big round of applause. Stratton's here with us, and while your principal asks you to behave yourselves now that we've got started, I'm going to give you one last chance in this generation of the selfie to say hello. Stratton, say hello. All right. As I like to say with my 4 and 7-year-olds, who also happen to think that Stratton Leopold is like Willy Wonka, you've gotten all your yah-yahs out now, and we're going to get started. So thank you so much for having me here. If you don't know me, you're watching the wrong channel. My name is Dave Cartoonin, and I anchor the morning news every morning on WSAB. It's called Coastal Sunrise, with Kim Gusby, who you should cheer much more loudly for. Here's Michelle. Kim's daughter goes here with you. And I'm here to tell you a little bit about the Passport to Excellence program. This is the first of 3 lectures, as your principal told you. Our next guest for this program is somebody named Don Baker, and I want to make sure I have this right. It's from WTOC, is that right? Never heard of it. And our third lecture guest is actually here with us in the room, Mr. Howard Morrison, who is like 99th generation Savannah and successful in his own right. He'll be joining us for the third part of our series as well. At this point, I want to tell you a little bit about the Passport to Excellence programs. We have these lecture series now in the district, but the whole program itself is to promote the value of a public education. Stratton had a public education here in Savannah. I am the product of a public education not too far from where Stratton is sitting right now in Orange County, California, and I'm delighted to be here with you to talk about what a public education can do for you to take you into your future. Passport to Excellence, however, isn't just these lectures. This program makes your class sizes smaller, it puts the right teachers in the right places, and it allows Savannah's public schools to be more competitive and more nurturing to you in your school system than many other school systems have the finances to do in other parts of the state. We should, because of this, thank the sponsors who are putting on this event. First, the title sponsor for this is JCB. I'm sure you've heard of them. Many of you may be working there someday. They're a great employer here in our community. They were founded by Joseph Sybil Bamford in 1945. They began 70 years ago with one machine in a small garage and a philosophy of continual innovation. And from there, they have developed into a privately held global company, including here in Savannah, with 11,000 employees. They manufacture a range of 300 products on four continents, sold throughout the world. They have a dealer network of 2,000 locations. They were introduced in North America 45 years ago. They continue to grow. They make significant investments in production and distribution. They deliver the most innovative and productive equipment solutions to both construction and agricultural markets. In particular, they've celebrated 15 years of business here in Savannah, so wave next time you drive by on I-95, and they have made local investments in their facility here. They employ 500 people in our community, and they manufacture the world's safest skid steer, the world's best-selling backhoe loader, and the world's toughest backhoe loader, which is in use by the United States military. So give JCB a round of applause and thank them for helping. Stagefront Productions, who has rigged us up to speak to Stratton live from Hollywood. 24E, one of those really, really cool stores down on Broughton Street, probably the coolest if you haven't been there. Maybe coolest after Leopold's, right down the street. Check them out. Healthy Savannah, Cecilia Russo Marketing, Carriage Trade Public Relations. Thank you to all of them for making this event possible. Really quickly, I'd like to invite up your superintendent to address you, tell you a little bit more about the program. Please give a big round of applause to Dr. Thomas Lawson.
Thank you very much, and good morning, Leopold. How are you?
Fine, thank you, Doctor. How about you?
All right, we're so happy that you're the first of the guest lecturers for the Passport to Excellence. And this is such an honor to have you lead it off. And to my students, good afternoon, students. How are you? Number one high school in the Savannah Chatham School District. To all of the guests that are here today, we're so happy that you joined us. To Marjorie Young, who from Carrie's Trader actually kicked this thing off and came to me, she says, I got an idea. And she planted that idea, and here we are. We also have Jason B, who's our premier sponsor. So we're so happy to have community partnerships. Otherwise, we couldn't. And without stage front, I can tell you, Mr. Hedeker over here, he was in charge of that, of the communications. I was very nervous. Thank you, stage front, for making this happen. And Kurt, he's so appreciative as well. We're here today because this is the first of three lectures that we're going to have this school. And as those lectures, we were saying to our students, you know, you can start in the elementary school and you never know where your future will lead you. Just like when I was in elementary school, when Stratton was in elementary school, who knows where you're going to end up. He was planning to go into medicine at some point, and he actually attended a couple of medical programs, and somewhere along the way he said, that's not for me. I want to go into the movie industry. And so from that, he moved along. But you know, he started at the Massie Heritage Center. And how many of you know about Massie School? You probably did when your education career have visited Massie. That's where he started in his elementary school. And you know, I don't think at that time you had to play in the boys' playground and the girls' playground. You couldn't play together. It was all divided. That was before your days. So he started there, but then he ended up at the Chatham Jr. High School, which is currently the central administration where I work on Broughton Street. So he had a bright future, and he moved on in his career from planning to be into the medical profession to ending up being the vice president of Paramount. Many of you have that same opportunity, and these lectures are for the students to see what we can be. The next lecture will be about business, how you can move from a general business background into banking. Maybe you start as a cashier checker. Then maybe you become a bank teller. And then maybe you become the bank president. So you have to start and then grow. Each of these lecturers that will be talking to us this year tell you about how they move through the system. We're so happy to have Mr. Will Cole with us. And I'd like to talk about your first name. I'm a first name person. We're so happy to have you, and we're happy to have the audience and students. I know you have some courageous questions about this future of some of you who want to become not just the vice president of Paramount, but you want to be the president. And And so ask those questions. He will tell you how to do it. Thank you so very much. Again.
All right, Stratton, I hope you can hear me okay. If you're like me, you hate having your resume read back to you. So I think Dr. Lockamy gave you a pretty good introduction, gave everybody a good feel for the things that you've done. And I know that people here don't just want to hear about you, they want to hear from you. So let's just get into it, if we could. First, it's funny because the students here, of course, we could do the "well, when I was your age" story. So we're going to start with that because when Stratton was in public schools here in Savannah, Chatham County, he's going to tell you all about it. It's still fresh in his memory because he's in his late 20s, so he can just, you know, look back on these things. When he was in public schools here, he did not take the Truman to get places. Truman was the president. So,
yes.
This is just a little slightly different. They've actually turned the schools that he went to into a heritage site and a central administration building. So, tell us about your experience. Tell us what public school in Savannah was like first starting at Massie in elementary school, and then just take us through your career a little bit.
Well, first at Massie, you walked to school because you live typically a couple of blocks away. And it was great. I mean, I think my years at Massie were typified by the fact that the classes were small, which we're going for again now, and the teachers had been there for many, many years. Ms. Wells, who taught first grade, had taught my brother 17 years before, so she was a long-term teacher there. And I think that generated an awful lot of goodwill, learning small class size. Looking back on Massie, I think there were some seminal events that happened there that led me into what I thought was my career, which was going to be medicine. Howard would remember this as well. In fourth grade, Mrs. Register brought in a big box and said science kit on it. And we attacked it voraciously. In there were batteries, were relays, were all sorts of things, were chemicals. We could burn sulfur and create, you know what. Anyway, it was just so much fun to get into that, to start learning and experimenting with ourselves. And in the fifth grade, I remember Ms. Counts at Massie, and it wasn't Massie Heritage, it was Massie School back then. We didn't know it was a heritage school. But in fifth grade, Ms. Counts passed out a book, and the title of the book was You. And I realized, and then she asks, what is the most interesting machine you've ever seen for the class? And you hear a locomotive, you hear an airplane. I'm looking at the book and I said, it's the human body. And that starts you thinking as to what the mechanics of a person, of a human, what the mechanics are. And that motivated me too. So those events were just seminal events that started me into the science area.
Now let's go to middle school a little bit. You move on to what was Chatham Middle School at the time. It's still there at 208 Full Street. What was a middle schooler's life like back in the early 1950s?
Well, it was. I'm sure different than it is now. We were required to take shop. And in the parking lot there was a shed. And in the shop I learned some woodworking, I learned some metal bending, which is actually, I must say, I still use those things. I think the focus of any school, whether it's elementary, junior high, on beyond, is to keep your mind open. Keep your mind open as to what may come your way. And it starts in the second, third grade, it starts. I think that's vital to every student.
It's a good thing to sort of piggyback onto keeping your mind open. One of the experiences that I had, switching from a parochial elementary school, a Catholic school with the nuns, and then going into a public school, was it does open your mind. You encounter all walks of life in public schools. I think it might be one of the richest experience of going to a public school. Can you talk about, in what was still the segregated South, what those eye-opening experiences were for you in the 1950s?
Sure. Well, in public school, you encounter folks, you encounter fellow students, right, every walk of life. And that rounds you, it makes you well-rounded, just meeting and dealing with people, too. I go back to the teachers. I remember Ms. Harrison in second grade, one day brings in a radio, and she tells us, I'm going to play you something. You won't know what it is now, but you'll think back on it in later years. It was Douglas MacArthur's, General MacArthur's speech to Congress, and old soldiers fade away, that speech. And we heard it in second grade. and didn't know what it was really, but then you think back on it. I think back on it now. I heard it live. But the teachers had the foresight to imbue the students with the thought, with the knowledge, and with the desire to learn more.
And now here in 2015, and speaking to an auditorium full of people living this experience now, you're one of the most connected guys I know in terms of understanding the way the 21st century world works. I mean, look at what we're doing right now, right? So what do you think those experiences are going to be to the 15, 16, 17-year-old student that's listening to you right now?
Well, I'm going to digress for 1 second. When you talk about stage front, always on stage statements, I also want to thank my friends here at Paramount, Lee Rosenthal, Matthew Ferrante, that helped set all this up. It's thanks to everyone and the IT folks at Savannah Arts and the Board of Ed. Thanks to everyone for doing this. Going on into the 21st century, there's a book on futurism I just read. I don't have it with me. And I think the opportunities over the next 50 years that these students in that auditorium, that you folks will have, are going to be amazing. I mean, those of you interested, you're going to be on Mars. It's going to be unbelievable. I wish I could be there. I mean, I keep thinking I was born in the wrong century. I want to fly to stars. But I mean, it's just the advances in medicine are going to be phenomenal, in all sciences, in literature, looking at motion pictures even. There's so many venues now for seeing films. That industry is exploding. This industry, I should say, I'm the Paramount. This industry is exploding as well. It's just incredible what's happening.
Well, there's another good thing to piggyback on, because if you've been to his ice cream shop, and I hope you have, if you see where he is now, if you know that he studied pre-med and then moved to Hollywood, essentially, you'll know that he has an incredible sense of wonder, and you're hearing it from him right now. You're going to the stars, you're going to Mars, and I wish I could be there with you. Well, I hope you will be there with us, Stratton.
I hope so, too.
But tell us how that has helped you, because pre-med to Hollywood is not your typical career track. And tell us about what that process was like.
Well, I was pre-med. My mom was a frustrated physician. My parents came from Greece. And mother was actually quite a good diagnostician. I mean, the doctors used to say when we became ill, whatever, measles, whatever it was, she would keep the graphs and everything of temperatures and what we, and they were great records she kept. But she was basically born in the wrong country at the wrong time, because a female physician back in those days in Greece, that wasn't going to happen. So I started out, my brother became a physician, my older brother. So then during school, when I went to Benedictine, I was part of the Joburg Secondary School Science Seminar, which Westinghouse Science Talent Search, I think they still do it. It was a science seminar, was definitely in business in Savannah. Westinghouse initially did it, and I was fortunate enough to be in the first group. So we, again, thinking broader, thinking what could possibly be, we were exposed to all avenues of science. I remember Dr. Miles and Dr. Pierce, James Miles and George Pierce at Oakland Island, before it was what it is now, it was the research center for the U.S. government. Alec Orman. Alec, God rest his soul, Alec was at Union Camp, and I became interested in rocketry. Alan would have machine Venturis for me, various nacelles. So we would go in his backyard, we had a concrete slab set up with a scale and a long wire behind the slab, and we would fire these rockets, just static testing, and see how much thrust we could get from various configurations and various nacelles. But that was all just expanding your mind. Did I love rocketry? Sure I did. Did I know? I had no idea what I was going to do. But again, I kept my mind open to what could be. And now, in this business, we can deal with rocketry. Of course, it's not real, but we still deal with it.
A message now from Savannah Chatham Schools Police. Do not launch rockets at Oakland Island, please. Take us into the room there now. You're in Hollywood at Paramount. You're working. Everyone can see, and I think this crowd in particular wants to know and wants to spend a significant amount of time, past to present. How did you get there? What are you doing now? And how can these kids do it too?
Okay, how I got here, my dad died, so I didn't go to med school, but I realized during the interim, I really didn't want to be a doctor. I was great in the sciences. I did quite well in the sciences. I didn't have the burning desire, but I didn't know what I wanted to do. So I moved to New York for a few years. I took a trainee job at Bose Corporation. And did that, and again, just looking, but I met an actress, and she, and with, through Carol, I became involved with theater as well and film. I would go with her, meet her friends in the film business, what have you. So when I was 20-something, I said, oh, I want to produce movies. I didn't know a thing. So I said, okay, I gave myself a number, I started with one, 5-year plans. Okay, in 5 years, I want to be here. And then after 5 years, I'm going to be here. So I just started dedicating myself to the following a dream, really, and I was very fortunate. The fortunate part for me, you've got to enjoy meeting people, because most businesses, especially motion pictures, it's a business of contacts. So I was fortunate enough to be in Atlanta in the early to mid-1970s, when the first time Atlanta became viable in film. And I got to meet studio heads. I remember Tom Mount. Tom was the youngest head of Universal Pictures. I could walk up to him, let's have a beer and talk. I mean, it was that sort of relationship in Atlanta, which I could network. And then when I finally came to Los Angeles many years ago, then I was ready to talk to folks and call folks and get involved in it. It was circuitous. I would recommend, back to what you asked me, those of you in the audience there who either acting or crew or directing, whichever aspect of it you're interested in, you can come to Hollywood immediately, and the magic could happen. It does happen occasionally, but more often than not, you've got to get a resume together. And I would recommend starting a smaller market. Savannah is now starting to grow as a film market. Atlanta certainly is mature as a film market. But these are the places that you can grow some, get a resume together. If you're a writer, God bless you, because if you write a hot script that somebody wants, that's your access right there. But get a resume together first.
Yeah, you know, speaking of which, how many times have you gotten this? Would you just take the script? Would you just read it? I got one for you. I got one.
Oh, yeah. Well, I'm sure you do. No, yeah, I try to think them all. I honestly do. I've got a stack like this, maybe even bigger than that. And I've been reading a few things. In fact, there's optional a couple of things too. So you try to read them all. It's difficult because you never know. You never know. Maybe a gem in there. You never know.
That's just sort of it, though. I think there are students here who are either learning or are going to learn about the gig economy, right? Does everyone sort of understand what that is? Could you have ever imagined that the gig economy would bring itself to Savannah, where young people who are interested in film, interested in acting, interested in crew, maybe even interested in other fine and performing arts, could start that process here when you were starting that process in little old Savannah, didn't have those things?
We're very fortunate to have the possibilities. Case in point, a couple of years ago, the 15-year-old daughter of a friend of mine calls me up, and she said, I'm going to sleep with you, fine. I want to be a music supervisor. It's the first time I've ever heard of anyone coming to me, mostly directing, acting, producing, camera, a music supervisor. But she knew at 15, and now I've introduced her to a couple of friends out here, and she's learning it. I mean, it's wonderful to know what you want, but even if you don't, just expose yourself in the film industry or in any industry. Expose yourself to all parts of it, and you'll figure it out. You'll figure out what you want.
You're talking about a certain lack of self-awareness and moxie that you sort of need to be able to sort of push back the fear or the reservation or whatever it is that's holding you back from going to that person and just saying, forget it, I'm just going to ask them for whatever it is I'm going to ask them.
Yeah.
Would you tell us your best story about just setting those things aside and saying, you know what, I'm just walking up to this person. I don't care if they don't even give me the time of day, because what do I have to lose?
I was really an assistant. I was hired to do a picture we shot at Macon called Wise Blood. I was not producing it. I was like second AD, second assistant, this. A man named John Houston was directing. Now, most of the students are not going to know who John Houston was. He was a famous director, obviously, an African queen. I mean, just the man has a filmography that's amazing. Anyway, I went straight up to him, and I said, Mr. Houston, I'm learning. May I ask you questions during the show, when we're filming? And I was like second assistant to back there somewhere. And he said, yes. And I did it. I asked him questions. Why did you shoot it like that? Why did you do this? And he was very, very, very forthcoming in helping me. And that's why I feel obligated to help as well, because I was helped a lot when I was coming up. But Houston was amazing, just an amazingly generous man with his advice. Little known fact, I directed a scene in that movie. I'll tell you about it some other time. But it's a matter of just being forward enough and having an opportunity. I tell this to students that come to the shop and we talk there. I tell them this, if we were in LA, I said, you would not be able to speak with me. Not because I may not want it, there are people designed to keep you away. But in Savannah, in Atlanta, in places, yes, I'm approachable, and other folks are as well. When the film that just finished in Savannah with Adam Sandler, Barry Bernardi produced it. Barry's been a friend for goodness, decades. And Barry, I mean, people, I would send people up to Barry, just up to him, and he would certainly speak with them and try to help them. In fact, one of our staffers, who's an actress, I mean, I said, go see Barry, he's my buddy, and she's in the movie somehow. So you've got to be capable and willing to talk to folks. And this is true in every industry, not just film. This is true in everything.
Yeah, there's a little certain truth to that, the things that I tell the young reporters who come through here in Savannah. Just come here and make the mistakes. The stakes are so much lower to make the mistakes here before you go off to the big bad world and everyone's watching. So you have this venue now here where kids can do this if they want to. You were always around if they wanted to. What's the best way to buttonhole you? What's the best way to, you know, get your ear for a moment? And what are the things that you like, you know, mentoring and sharing about for all these people who are suddenly going to be lining up on Broughton Street to hear?
Well, for all 800 of them, see, I have to get in line. I prefer it to shop because then we can grab a table and talk. I'm in and out of there. The best thing is just make sure I'm there because I'm in and out. I try to be there a lot because I enjoy being there. I started washing glasses at that very same sink behind the soda fountain when I was about 10 or 11 or 12. So, I mean, it's a lot of my father and my uncles. I think about that when I'm there and I enjoy it. So, be there and just call and come on down.
I like it. I'm first.
Okay.
This program, first off, there are a lot of people who have questions for you, so I'm going to introduce one of your fellow students so that she can ask some of the questions. Before I do that, so this program, when it was pitched to you, what did you think, what is it about public education that can be special for people, and why did you agree to get involved?
It's vital. It's vital that we stay in school, graduate, and become part of the community, the fabric of the community. It's vital for the individual. It's vital for Savannah. It's vital for industry. It's needed so much for us to stay in and graduate, because your horizons will be unlimited. Small story, as one of our staffers, he's a high school graduate, was washing glasses at my same sink I used to wash glasses at. And I asked him, I said, what are your goals? Because most of our staffers will move on to other careers. He said, I want to be a team leader here at the shop. And I said, think a lot higher than that. Just go for it, think a lot higher. And he said, thank goodness he's still with us. He's now our number two person at Ice Cream, and we'll be number one in a couple of years. So it's a matter of just going for it, and of just thinking high. As I think Roger Moss says it too, go for the moon, and you know, you'll get partway there at least. And I'm sorry, Dave, I'll keep talking for a second. No, and I think this program is vital for many reasons. That's the main thing, is stay in school, graduate, go on, it's become a vital part of Savannah.
I was just all excited for the Roger Moss plug there, too. I think there are a bunch of people in here who know who that guy is. He's out doing amazing things right now in Europe, I believe. Let me take a second to introduce to you somebody you already know, but I love introducing students like Jessica Longoria because it amazes me what the 21st century teenager is doing. It also terrifies me. It makes me glad that I graduated from high school back in 1970, So, Jessica is planning on becoming a neonatal nurse. She already has a ballroom dancing career. She's a working professional, you might say. And she took an AP statistics test this morning. Once again, why don't we have Stratton, let me introduce to you Jessica Logoria, who's going to take it away.
Hi, everyone. How's everyone doing? Good? Hey, Mr. Leopold. It's so nice to see you. AP stats, one test in a day. Ooh, that's a low record for Savannah Arts. Am I right? Am I right? you have done so much for Savannah Arts and for the local community here. But can I just ask you a question real quick? Can I be second in line for that mentorship program? Is that acceptable?
You can probably elbow your way out of the day and just get number one, too.
Okay, that might be possible. I've got a good right to cook, so. But now I think that this question, these are questions from the students, and I think that this one definitely applies to many quote-unquote starving artists in Savannah Arts who would like to pursue film or acting or something of that nature. Now we understand that you attended Vanderbilt as well as Georgia Tech, correct? For pre-med. Now, how did you muster up the courage to drop pre-med and go to pursue your passion?
I just did it.
Well, I think that's a good answer. So just get out there and do it. Is that what you're telling us?
I didn't hear you.
Oh, I'm sorry. So you're just basically telling us to just pursue our passion and do it? Is that right?
It's a little goofy. I can't. It sounds a little goofy.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I was just making sure that you're just telling us to hurry up and pursue our passion and go for your dreams, go for the goal.
Yeah. I mean, you have to be. You have to be open to change because I mean, your goals. I'll wait till you finish, Dave. Your goals may change as you go along, but yes, I mean, be prepared, just go for it. You have to, I feel. But the main thing is stay in school. Graduate from school, that's vital. That really is vital.
Absolutely. Now, when we do get to the goal, quote unquote, or when we do make it, maybe a VP of Paramount Pictures, now, why do you feel like it's important to give back to your community? Because we all know that you donate to Savannah and you participate in programs like the Passport to Excellence program. So why is that important?
It's important to me because I'm from Savannah. I love being there. I enjoy it so much. And as I mentioned, I was helped an awful lot by a lot of folks when I was coming out. All across the spectrum, in Atlanta, mostly in LA, all over New York as well. So a woman named Juliet Taylor in New York really started me in the business. She's a retired cast member, and she does all of Woody Allen's movies. But the fact that I was helped so much, it makes me feel good to help somebody else too. And when you see talent, and for instance, another of our staffers, I keep going back to that, is an amazing artist. I mean, his work is fantastic. So I asked him, I said, do you ever want to think about that? And he said, well, I don't know. And I said, if you do, and I spoke to someone at SCAD, I said, we let him audit some classes. Because the guy's talented. And when you see talent, especially, you want it to go where it could go, it should go.
Well, thank you so much for that insight. I think that was really helpful for the students of Savannah Arts. Right, guys? Yeah? majors at Savannah Arts. As you might know, some are vocal, some are orchestra. And when you ask a vocal major what their favorite song is, we just kind of say, I don't know. I don't know. I mean, we sing constantly. So for you as a film producer, what would you say your favorite film is? And that might be kind of vague, but what is your favorite film that you've produced?
The favorite film that I've done in terms of a film was probably The Sum of All Fears. It was also a difficult picture to make, but as far as a movie, as far as a film standing on its own, Mission Impossible was a huge, huge fun. We would travel the world, but it was a lot of fun. The film that I probably learned the much on, the aforementioned Wise Blood, which we shot in Macon, that was a watershed event for me. And not only for me, for a lot of the Atlanta crew back then, we were all learning. We were doing two or three jobs, just learning, wanting to learn. And we did a screening a couple of years ago in Savannah as a benefit for the Flannery O'Connor home, the childhood home in Savannah. And we screened it at the Jackson Center. And I did a Q&A afterward with one of the actors in. And I got up on the dais, on the podium there, and I said, you know, I have not seen the movie in probably 25 years. But, I said, our hearts were all over that screen. It was palpable. And what we poured into it, learning, not knowing, just it was an amazing experience. And we've done this now on MI3, actually. We had some interns in Los Angeles that came from Savannah on that picture. And again, for them, it was an amazing event to be at the studio here, working on, at that time, the largest movie Paramount had done. So we hope that that same experience will translate and you get the fire going, or continue the fire, I should say, that they really want to do this.
Yeah, well, I think it definitely shows on screen. How many of us have seen Mission Impossible? Yeah? How many of us have seen Captain America? Yeah. Right? Yeah? Okay, well, thank you so much for that. You know, going into your career, obviously, for me, you know, ballroom dancing and for many of us local artists, you know, we can't do it without support. So who would you say has supported you throughout your entirety of your career?
Well, my wife has supported me because I've had a week for years at a time sometimes. But in terms of philosophically, I've had a number of friends that I can think of that have helped me out along the way, mostly here in Los Angeles. But it's been that way throughout my career. I've been fortunate enough during the Atlanta days and New York even to have, which is why I want to help if I can. I've been helped a lot, so you try to give back and help as much as you can.
Absolutely, absolutely. I definitely agree with that. Now, I have a question from another student. Now, when you started off in New York and pursued Los Angeles, did you feel that being from the South, you were stereotyped in any way?
No, I wasn't. I would never have allowed that either. I would have gone straight through that. It's interesting. During my early years in Los Angeles, and I was here, 20-something, whatever, a long time. My early years, I wear like blue shirts or golf shirts and khakis. I have khakis on right now. During the early years in Los Angeles, that was sort of not the way people dressed. And I would go to a party and something, people's feelings sort of a little wild, look at you, and I said, yeah, that's me. I would not change. I'm not going to change because whatever the gold chains and all that foolishness. No. It's be yourself. Have your goals. Have all of that. But be yourself. And now, let me continue today before we cut me off there. And again, speaking to writers especially, I envy writers so much because I can write a treatment, that's about it. But I envy writers, screenwriters, because if the play is the thing, it does start, it all starts right there. And they have an opportunity, if they write something really fantastic, like what Stallone did with the first Rocky. I mean, the studio wanted to buy it from him and cut him out, and he kept saying no, 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 and he stood around. A writer has that opportunity to do that. If it's a really hot script, yes, you have the opportunity. It's difficult, and you'll throw money. I shouldn't say they, I'm sitting here. The studio will try to buy it from you, but I'm going to whisper stuff as a Wall Street editors in Los Angeles, and they'll try. But stand your ground. If it's something you really believe in, and write what's here. Many writers will often try to catch a trend. That's write what's here. At this point in my career, the books that I've optioned and the things I want to do, I'm fascinated by immutable change in characters. I love that aspect of life, and that's what I want to tell now.
Well, thank you so much for that insight. Now, I think we're all dying to know this one last question. What is your favorite flavor of ice cream?
In all honesty, it changes. I mean, I'll get into buttermilk pecan for a while, and then I'll get into caramel swirl. Because we make our own caramel, and it reminds me of butterscotch. And I love butterscotch. I love vanilla. I mean, it just changes. But you see, I have access to all of them. So.
Well, thank you so much for taking the time to talk to us and meeting me. I hope you have a wonderful day, and I'll turn it back to Dave.
Jessica, you need to stand here, because one of the lessons of the earlier portion of our conversation was just shedding all of that pretense and stepping past it. And Jessica had another question there that I am trying to look through that she didn't ask, and I'm going to make her ask. Where's the mentor question? Here we go, Stratton.
Okay,
well, you've done so much for Savannah, and you've been a great supporter of Savannah Arts. Now, can I personally contact you to be my mentor?
Yes, you can. The two women sitting in the front row have an email address.
There you go. Jessica Longoria, you just scored yourself a mentor. Let this serve as a lesson that when you have the opportunity, shed what everybody may think about you and just ask. Give a round of applause. Now, Scott, we've got a few more minutes with you, so I want to go back to one of these themes that seems to be coming up over and over and over again, and that is failure. And for me, somebody said to me in my early adult life, you know, it's really a shame you haven't, you know, that it really took you this long to really screw up. And I kind of looked at them and said, what do you mean? If you just fail early on in big ways, it just gets so much easier to achieve later on. So talk about the importance of failure through your career, and particularly at this ripe age in high school where everyone is just so concerned about what people think of them, what's going to happen if something goes wrong, and where the importance of those experiences come from.
Okay, well, we'll talk about that, and also at the end of that, I want to talk about businesses in Savannah and what we can do to help. I want to talk about that as well. Failure. You're going to fail. At some point, probably multiple times, probably. And depending, and especially those of you who are acting, my goodness, that's difficult, because you deal with failure almost every audition. That happens a lot. So it's a matter of how you deal with it. You have to be fairly sanguine about it and say, okay, I will proceed, I will do better. I've failed a number of times on pictures and before. I was fortunate enough, early in my career, I worked for a company called Film Finances, which is a completion guarantor. And I was their international hit guy, if you will. I would go in on movies that had gone bad and take them over, basically, for the people that had the money behind them. But you can learn so much from something from a movie that had failed, financially especially. Why did it fail? What happened? Was it involved in casting? Was it production? But that teaches you, and I think each of you out there, when you encounter failure, let it be a teaching tool. Learn from it, because you most certainly will. And the thing about failure is, try not to repeat it, of course. But other things will happen. Other things will happen. On to the business thing. Touched on it a second ago. We try to help as a business by doing ice cream parties for some of the elementary schools, for reading programs, what have you, with the library, with the writing program, and with the I Pledge thing. But I would encourage other businesses in Savannah, get involved in the school system. See what you can do as a business to encourage folks to stay, encourage students to stay in school, to encourage that, because it only helps business, but it mostly helps the individual student.
Tell me, and I genuinely don't know the answer to this, were you first in your family to graduate from college? Or to go to college?
No.
Okay.
No, my brother and sister were.
But first generation.
Yeah.
So, public school is another venue for that, and I wanted to touch on it because you are, of course, the son of immigrants. And many of you, in a public setting, will be surrounded by peers, or maybe yourself, the first person in your family to head to college, or the first person to finish college, or the first person to get a master's degree, or even the first person to become a lawyer or a doctor. Talk about, because you made such a departure from pre-med to film, talk about what that pressure is like being among the first generation of your family to achieve these things, and what advice you have for people in this auditorium or people who may watch this later who may have the fear of stepping out and not following down the same path that is safe that maybe their family has followed in previous generations.
Well, I was fortunate enough that my parents wanted me to progress and do things. I was being pushed, so which is good. But even if you're not, I mean, it's a matter of each individual wanting to do it. It comes from here, wanting to do it. Follow your dream. If your dream is medicine, follow your dream. If your dream is architecture, get a summer job. I mean, I used to draw pictures of layouts of homes in first grade. I'll find them and show them to you. But I didn't know what I was going to do. But just follow your dream there. It's it goes hand in hand with failure. You may fail at what you initially want to do. It's possible. But then you regroup and look at it. Okay, maybe I shouldn't have been a dentist. Or maybe I shouldn't be in pre-dental. Maybe I should be a writer. Then maybe I should be an anchor. I mean, it's no. It's a matter of within yourself defining what you think at that moment you want to do, following that, but always being open to change.
I say no, don't do it for two reasons. Number one is because there are far more talented people in this auditorium than I will ever be, and I don't want them to take my job until I'm done with it. And number two, I work so hard so that my kids don't have to go and do what I had to do. So if you want to become a news anchor, see me afterward. I'll be happy to tell you about all the ways I failed as well. What's next for you?
Well, what's next for me there are a couple of films, two and a half, I like to say. One movie, the book is entitled Charlie Two Shoes and the Marines of Love Company, published by Naval Institute Press. David Perlman, one of the writers' mother, is from Savannah. So that book, it's a wonderful book. It sat on the coffee table for a long time. And my wife Mary said, you should read this book. And I read it. And I immediately called David and said, let's make a film. That we've gotten a screenplay done. I'm meeting back in LA late this month with some Chinese friends that are coming over of a potential investment in it. The other one, which is, I should get a script in about a week on it. It's a book written by a fellow named Neil White in Oxford, Mississippi, called In a Sanctuary of Outcasts, a wonderful story. It's a memoir, it's his story. He was incarcerated in a minimum security federal prison. Why the why is in the book, you can get the book and read it. But the story arc is this. He was flying high and mighty, goes to this minimum security prison, federal prison in Carville, Louisiana. Yes, James Carville's family. It was one half prison, the other half the United States leper colony. This is 20 years ago. And the influence that the lepers had upon him And his character arc is amazing. He's a wonderful man. And the other thing the audience has to realize there is when you hear Leper, oh my God, stay away, at the end of the film, they have to love them for what they did to Neil, for how they helped him, and then they helped him mightily. The one half is Tom Colvin and Savannah. Tom has written a wonderful musical. Again, it's a true story. He performed it here in Los Angeles to really good reviews. He's taken it to New York now. But the story itself, true story again, about a man named J.B. It's still in Sandersville area of Georgia, and a fellow named a doctor, a physician. It's a relationship story. As I said earlier, change in character, immutable change, fascinates me. And that's what this is as well. How the influence these two men have on each other. And these are small movies, nothing like this thing. I mean, that's huge. These are small, but that just fascinates me. The story is fascinating.
So for the people who aren't familiar with it then, talk about the lifeline. Just pick one of those projects. And whether you're at the beginning of any one of those lifelines, explain, you know, cradle to grave, how that process works for you.
On which ones? On the studio picture or on the other ones I mentioned? On which ones?
You pick one of the ones you're working on right now.
Okay. Let's look at In the Sanctuary of Outcasts, which is Neil White's book. I've optioned the rights to the book, which means I have a motion picture, the right to make a motion picture from it. The screenplay, I've commissioned the screenplay, which is due the 1st of September. I've been in Jackson, Mississippi, talking to folks there in terms of what we can do with it, because it'll film down in that area probably, because it takes place in that whole area. And at this point, we're waiting for a screenplay. Once we get the screenplay, then we'll get some financial interest behind it. And then we'll cast it. We'll cast it, get a director involved, start fine-tuning it, and God bless, sign your fingers crossed, then we'll go make a film. On the studio side, it's very different, because when I was at an office here for goodness, a long time at Paramount, when this picture, MI3 started, I was actually on staff, I was an EVP here, and it was one of my pictures, and Tom and Paula Wagner, who was his co-producer back then, came to me and said, we want you to produce a picture. I said, I can't, I'm an executive here. Make a long story short, management, but Brad Gray then said, you can take a leave of absence to do it. And it was a year and a half on one of these larger movies from start to finish. I was all through marketing. And that's, again, that's a long time. But again, a wonderful experience.
Is that why Tom Cruise is looking at you like that right now? Turn around.
Oh, yeah.
The picture here in the auditorium, he is he is looking into your soul, Stratton. All right.
Yes.
We're running out of time, so I want to give you the opportunity to tell one last story, share one last lesson, one last character trait from public school that you may have learned, anything that you want to leave with this group before you say goodbye.
I would just tell all of you, and to tell all of your friends, all the students, get up all over Savannah. School is probably the most important years, the most important years of your life. Stay in school, graduate from school, have a dream, follow your dream. Your dream may change. Be prepared for that. But if it changes, okay, it changes. Just follow that path. And you may change two or three times, it's hard to say. But be prepared for that, follow your dream, stay in school.
Savannah Arts, say goodbye to Stratton Leopold. We're gonna turn the camera for you. Everybody say goodbye. Stratton Leopold.
Thanks to all of you for coming.
All right, ladies and gentlemen. 6 test. I hope you enjoyed yourselves. I want to say thank you one more time to JCB, to 24E on Broughton Street, to the school district, to Marjorie and Cynthia and Cecilia and to Healthy Savannah. Without their support, programs like these would not be available for all of us to take part in. Thank your principal, and most importantly, because I know he is going to hate this, who's seen Back to the Future? See, there is hope for the next generation. All right, so Doc Brown, right? Doc Brown holds the plugs together and the DeLorean goes plowing down the street in Hill Valley, and like at the last moment with the lightning, it bolts and it goes through him, he's holding it together, and Marty is back off to 1985, right? Doc Brown at this school is Tommy Lovin. And please say thank you to him. The guy. So Tommy, thank you to you, my friend, and thank you to everybody for coming. I'm going to hand it back over to your principal so we don't make this look like a fire drill, and have a wonderful afternoon.
Okay, before we go, I just want to thank, of course, Mr. Cartoonin and Jessica, and I also would like to take this opportunity to welcome and give a big Savannah Arts welcome to Julie Wade, our District 1 Board of Education representative. She's a great supporter of Savannah Arts, you know, you've seen her at a lot of our events. And of course, she was able to sneak in after we got started, so welcome once again. She's already told me she's not going to say anything.